We welcome all who worship with us in person and all who worship with us online. For those of us who are worshiping at a distance, if you would like to follow along with our order of worship and participate in our shared meetings and prayers, today's bulletin is posted on our church's website. Near or far, it is good to worship together. We have one big announcement for this week, and it's great news. The Mercy Center's shelves are well stocked. They've asked us to stop giving them food for right now. They have all they need, which is great news. That's wonderful. That's a serious need in our community, and right now they're doing well. Please check the cornerstone for information as to when that will change, because we know it will. People are still in need, and they will need more food from us. So please check the cornerstone for when the outreach committee will start collecting food again. We light the altar candles, and we invite those of you who are worshiping at home to also light a candle, together acknowledging the presence of Christ in our midst. Let us turn to God in the attitude of worship.
Grace and peace be with you. I invite you to rise in body or in spirit that together we might share the call to worship we find printed before you. Our souls proclaim your greatness, O God,
and our spirits rejoice in you. We will praise you as long as we live.
We will trust in you, the one who gives food to the hungry, the one who enacts justice for the oppressed.
Our souls proclaim your greatness, O God.
I invite you to be seated. Let us take this time in prayer. God of all time, we are so ready to be done with upheaval. We are so ready to be done with limitations. We are so ready to be done with uncertainty. And yet uncertainty is not done with us yet. And so continue to teach us the spiritual gifts of hope, of seeing one another with compassion, of looking at the world with curiosity, and of wrestling our own joy out of these days. We pray with our frayed patience and our worn-out plans, trusting ourselves to you once again. Awaken in us this day, we pray, the gift of seeing the delicate web of connection between ourselves and others. In a world of tension, we pray for those who live in dangerous places, for those who live in areas of war or strife, for those who live in times of turmoil. We pray for the people of Haiti. We pray for the people of Afghanistan. We pray for all who live in fear, for those who worry about employment or food, for those who struggle just to find dignity in life. May your grace bring peace and safety to all your children. As we come in contact with others this day, as we work together or talk together, hold a tired hand or speak a patient word, help us to find your grace in each other. And if in the coming days we aggravate each other or speak or hear harsh words or feel disappointment, help us to find your divine spark in each other. We are so grateful for the places where our lives do touch, as we know that you carry and care for us all. And so with thanks for the holy breath in all of us, we offer the prayer our Lord invites. say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us take this time in a moment of silent prayer. Our journey with King David, and you may recall that last week we looked at his sin against Bathsheba. Today's passage follows immediately on the heels of that story. It's coming to us from 2 Samuel chapter 11, verse 27 through chapter 12, verse 13. The thing that David had done displeased the Lord, and the Lord sent Nathan to David. Nathan came to him and he said to him, There were two men in a certain city, the one rich and the other poor. The rich man had very many flocks and herds, but the poor man had nothing but one little ewe lamb, which he had bought. He brought it up, and it grew up with him and his children. It used to eat of his meager fare and drink from his cup and lie in his bosom, and it was like a daughter to him. Now there came a traveler to the rich man. He was loath to take one of his own flock or herd to prepare for the wayfarer who had come to him. But he took the poor man's lamb and prepared that for the guest who had come to him. Then David's anger was greatly kindled against the man. He said to Nathan, As the Lord lives, the man who has done this deserves to die. He shall restore the lamb fourfold because he did this thing and because he had no pity. Nathan said to David, You are the man. Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, I anointed you king over Israel, and I rescued you from the hand of Saul. I gave you your father's house, and I gave you your master's house, and your master's wives into your bosom, and I gave you the house of Israel and of Judah. And if that had been too little, I would have added as much more. Why have you displeased the word of the Lord to do what is evil in God's sight? You have struck down Uriah the Hittite with the sword and have taken his wife to be your wife and have killed him with the sword of the Ammonites. Now, therefore, the sword shall never depart from your house, for you have despised me and have taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your wife. Thus says the Lord, I will raise up trouble against you from within your own house. And I will take your wives from before your own eyes and give them to your neighbor, and he shall lie with your wives in the sight of this very son, for you did it secretly. But I will do this thing before all Israel and before the sun. David said to Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. In March of this year, Forbes magazine had an article entitled, Why Your Organization Needs a Chief Accountability Officer. And the author of that piece wrote, and I quote, As we navigate multiple seismic changes, including the pandemic, racial justice, and dissident factions in our communities and country, I found that true outside advisors are better at holding not just the CEO, but other people in the company accountable for following through on their commitments. CAOs, Chief Accountability Officers, are there to help people live up to their promises and agreements for their own good and for the good of others. The basis for the role is driven by the need for someone who will speak truth to power and ask the questions others are afraid to ask. They should stay above the fray of company politics and continually strive for the betterment of the organization, its employees, and its customers. They're not motivated by the next promotion. They're genuinely looking to help the country, the company. A top CAO always puts the greater good of the organization first, end quote. So we've been following the story of King David of Israel, and today his chief accountability officer, Nathan, is worth his weight in gold. We may remember that many weeks back we looked at the story of David being selected as the up-and-coming king when King Saul had fallen from grace. And as a youth, David is anointed in his own backyard. He's the youngest of a household of many sons, and he is the unexpected recipient of God's claim and call. And on the occasion of his being named the next in line for the throne, David is just a kid. He's busy outside in the field keeping watch over the family sheep. So he starts his journey serving God from the position of a young shepherd. And that shepherd image is not lost as he makes his way into power. In 2 Samuel 5, when King Saul has died and the tribes are coming together to officially affirm that David will be their king, they revisit this shepherd image. They say, "The Lord said to you, it is you who shall be shepherd of my people Israel, you who shall rule over Israel." A shepherd is one who will care for, guard, protect, and nurture the flock. Now in last week's episode of Bathsheba and her husband Uriah, David misuses his role as shepherd of the people of Israel. He misuses it for his own purposes. You may recall from last week that David assaulted Bathsheba and ultimately had her husband Uriah killed in order to cover up his sin and his crime. And in that situation, rather than being primarily concerned about the care of and the justice for the people, David abused Bathsheba, Uriah, and the community by twisting the power of his role as their shepherd. So someone needs to call David out. Someone needs to hold him accountable for his sin. What he's done is he's trying to make others clean up his mess, but the mess is his alone. Like there's a sign on the lawn of a public field in New Hampshire seeking to call dog owners to accountability, and the sign read, "There is no poop fairy here." God asks us to attend to the messes we make on lawns or in life, and so David will discover such today. Toward that end, Nathan uses the image of sheep in his clever story as he tries to get David to realize the profound error of his ways. And Nathan is the prophet who serves as the key religious advisor to David. You'll recall from a couple of weeks ago when we looked at discernment, we met Nathan, newly then the spiritual leader who has access to David. He's clearly someone that David trusts. Nathan is David's chief accountability officer. And so Nathan cannot and really will not ignore it when David so blatantly abuses his power. David has committed offenses against the flock and has committed offenses against God. And so Nathan will speak up. Now I'd like you to imagine that you are Nathan. And consider for a moment, what's your usual style when you have to confront someone? Think about that. So if you're Nathan, and you've got your usual style, how would you go about confronting David? Would you storm into his room in the palace and read a riot, yell at him at the top of your lungs? Or would you, leave him a note on the fridge, something like, "David, we have to." Or would you give him the cold shoulder until he kind of wonders, what's going on? Or would you drop hints along the way, hope he put it all together? Well, that obviously doesn't become Nathan's style. Nathan doesn't do any of those patterns. Rather, he's confronting a king, and even as an established prophet, this act is going to come with tremendous danger. And so instead of having any sort of a direct conversation with David, Nathan then circles the issue by telling David a story. He tells of two men, one's rich and one's poor. And the rich one has a huge flock of sheep, and the poor one just has one little lamb that has become something of a beloved family pet. The rich man ends up with unexpected guests and, of course, must provide a meal for those guests, but he doesn't want to use any of his own large flock of sheep. So instead, he takes the poor man's beloved pet lamb and uses that for the meal. End of story. Now, upon hearing Nathan's story of this grave injustice, David has an outburst of anger. He declares his indignation at the obvious unfairness of this rich man. And he shouts out loud, the man has no pity, he has no compassion. And we can sort of picture David getting all red in the face. He's probably pounding the walls with his fist. David immediately grasps that there is injustice in this situation. But he hasn't grasped the connection with his own sin. He still doesn't see what God needs him to see. There's an old tale about a man who was wearing a very strange coat. All down the front, there were patches of various sizes and shapes, mostly large patches. And when he was asked, why is your coat patched in such a remarkable way, he answered that the patches represented the sins of his neighbors. And so he could point to any given patch and tell the story of the sin of someone in the neighborhood. And then on the back of the coat, there was a single patch. And so he was asked, what's that patch about? He said, that is my own sin, and I cannot see it. When Nathan tells his story about his two men and their sheep, David doesn't see himself in the story. He clearly sees everybody else's sin, but not his own. And so Nathan takes that opportunity to bring the point home. The scripture says, David's anger was greatly kindled against the man. He says, as the man lives, the man who's done this should die. He'll restore the lamb fourfold. He did this thing. He had no pity. And in that moment, you can kind of picture Nathan taking a deep breath. And then with powerful simplicity, Nathan says, you are the man. David has finally been called on the carpet. His companion Nathan has risked speaking the word of truth to someone in ultimate power. Now, fortunately, Nathan has found a way to awaken David's conscience and alert him to his blindness and his arrogance. David couldn't see his own sin, so Nathan risks everything in being brutally honest at that moment so that David would open his eyes. The scripture goes on to tell us that David truly and fully came to realize the gravity of his sinful situation. He repents, he seeks and receives God's forgiveness, and Psalm 51 is traditionally understood as the expression of David's repentance. Sort of picture David crumbling at that moment and then going in his room and writing out a prayer to God as he realizes what he has done. And that prayer comes out as Psalm 51. David grasps the depth of his guilt and he's awakened to his profound need for God's forgiveness. And as important as David's repentance is, I really would rather focus for these moments on Nathan, because Nathan is really where the action is. Look at what Nathan has done. He has spoken up to authority. He has advocated for the marginalized and has confronted the powers that be. Nathan has taken a stand. He's decided that he will not silently or passively accept his king's abuse of power. He wonderfully fulfills his role as a prophet, speaking truth to power. And he spoke up so that the disenfranchised, the marginalized, the victimized, the powerless will have justice. Nathan spoke up so that things would change. But take another moment now and think, for what would you like to take a stand in today's world? Are there situations in which you long to make a difference, you long to speak up or stand up. And in those situations, for whom would you be advocating? Because that's what Nathan is doing. He is advocating for others. Now, clearly, Nathan had the good fortune of the fact that David saw the light. David didn't justify his actions, you know, he didn't deny the truth or turn on Nathan. Nathan got through to David and was successful. But we shouldn't be fooled into thinking that that's always going to be the case. Confronting power isn't always going to be that easy. Speaking up for change, confronting authority, comes with conflict. It comes with risk. We think of other biblical stories in which one of God's people confronted and spoke up in this advocacy sort of way. Remember Esther, when she spoke up on behalf of the entire Jewish nation and she risked her very life. Or we remember how Elijah spoke up to Ahab and Jezebel and then he had to run for his life. Or then we think of John the Baptist speaking up and confronting King Herod. He lost his life. Speaking up is a big part of our faith story, and it is a risky part of our faith journey. Over and over, we are reminded that there is injustice in the world, and God uses us to confront that which must be confronted, and it is risky work. But we must also be clear that speaking up isn't just a kind of careless venting of our frustration, right? We have enough of that in our world today. We all want to vent our frustration here and there, right? But that faithful advocacy is something more than that. Speaking up is not just an arbitrary personal condemnation of all the list of things that I don't like, right? Nathan was not engaged in some finger-pointing just to make himself feel superior. Speaking up or speaking out on God's behalf does not consist in being a tattletale, running around, pointing out problems, or accusing others, or disparaging them for their faults or their sins. That may feel good sometimes, right? But that's not prophetic speech. That's not faithful advocacy. Faithful advocacy has three important dimensions. First, faithful advocacy is always based on kingdom values. When Nathan spoke up, he did so well grounded in a vision of how God's people are supposed to treat one another. He had a clear sense of the covenant that was running beneath the relationships between God and God's people. Things like, God doesn't want the weak to be exploited. Power comes with accountability. Each person is a precious child of God and beloved in God's sight. These are kingdom values. And it was with a clear sense of these kingdom values that led the Methodist Church generations ago to work vigorously toward changing child labor laws. It was with a clear sense of kingdom values that led Dr. King to speak the word of equality and lead the Montgomery bus boycott. And it's with a clear sense of kingdom values that leads United Methodists today to seek a truly, fully inclusive church. And so as we speak, we consider speaking up in our world as individuals, or as a community, the first step is always in identifying what kingdom values undergird our position. How would you name the matters of faith, the God reasons, if you will, that are at play in that thing you feel must be changed? What values guide you? How is your message rooted in your faith? Secondly, faithful advocacy is rooted in community. Notice that David and Nathan are both part of a faith community. This isn't an insider speaking to an outsider. Nathan's confrontation with David understood that they were connected. They were bound to each other. They were both part of a sacred body and a sacred community. And so when Nathan spoke, he spoke for that community. When Nathan confronted David, he was seeking to restore that bond. When we speak out about change that needs to be made in our world, we must do so in a fashion that understands we are one human community. We are connected to each other. While Nathan probably felt like he was out there on his own, he was actually speaking form a community of faith. Prophets often look like lone rangers, but in reality, they represent something much larger than themselves. Prophets, like Nathan, know well the importance of the covenant community. It's our lifeblood. It's really our identity. And for Christians, when we speak out, we do so representing a very specific community of faith and witness. So as we consider speaking up in our world, the second step is to ask ourselves, as you work for change, are you staying connected to the Christian community for support and accountability? Is what you are doing consistent with the community life? Will it build the bonds of community? And third, faithful advocacy has a particular goal. The goal is not mere guilt. The goal is new life. Nathan confronted David. David's eyes were open. He saw his sin. He was crushed with guilt. But if that being crushed with guilt moment was the end of the story, what good would have come of it? It wasn't enough that David felt guilty. It was important that he also reach out for new life, a new start, the kind of forgiveness and the gift of life that comes with redemption. Only with new life would the people benefit from David's insight. David asks God's forgiveness. He receives it. He starts afresh and goes on to lead God's people with this humbling experience. And in that respect, prophets are meant to be kind of like midwives, not tattletales who make a game of accusing wrongdoers, seeking only to make them feel badly or make them feel small or make them feel less, but rather midwives whose aim is new life, the goal that a person or a situation can truly find new life. So the third consideration, as we find ourselves maybe being called to speak to a world in need of change, is what would new life look like in this situation? And are our methods helping to bring that new life about? So, where in our world do you sense a need for justice? Where in our world are you feeling drawn to the issue of liberation? Where in our world are you feeling called to stand and speak? God may be calling you to speak out. You may be the Nathan that some David needs. And as you respond to that call, remember to, number one, ground your work in the values on which the kingdom of God is built. Prophets don't speak arbitrarily. They are rooted in God's vision of the kingdom. Number two, remember to ground your work in the value, stay connected rather to the covenantal community. Prophets don't speak for themselves alone, they speak for people. So number two, stay connected to the faith community. And number three, work in such a way that new life will be the end result. Prophets are agents of what God does best, which is life. Let us pray. Lord God, wherever you have called us to make a difference, empower us and embolden us to be your agents of change. In your name we pray. Amen. We invite you to rise in body or in spirit that together we might share the responsive prayer you find in your book. Loving God of power and justice and peace, in our broken world, we see the new order.
Where there is courage to speak truth to power.
We seek a new order.
Where there is abundant time for healing.
We seek a new order.
Where there is peace and freedom for all. Guide us, God of power, to live out these dreams.
Amen. I invite you to be seated.
all God's people said.
Amen.
Friends, your offering last week empowered ministry right here locally, but also supported ministries from beyond us. As we think about the students heading back to college, you might be well to know that through our denominational giving, it also supported the work of our chaplains across the United Methodist Church. And there's a particular program that supports leading students to a greater sense of well-being. It's been developed by chaplains and staff of the denomination. The program is geared to help students build resiliency as it aims to guide them with contemplative practices in the anxious life that can take place for a college student. This and many other ministries happen thanks to the way the people of the United Methodist Church live and give connectionally. I invite you to give generously. You're welcome to use either plate at either doorway, or you're always welcome to access our online giving portal. Will you join with me in the responsive prayer of dedication you'll find in your bulletin? Giving God, we give you thanks and praise for all your gifts to us.
We know that you are the source of every good thing. Life and love and come from you.
You have given us so much, and it is because we recognize the gifts you have given to us that we now give to the work of your kingdom.
As we dedicate this offering, we offer ourselves too. For these gifts of mine are but tokens of ourselves.
Take and use us, that our hands may reach out in service, our feet may walk the difficult path of reconciliation, and that our words may be words of peace.
For this we pray in the name of Jesus.
Amen. I invite you to rise in body and spirit for our closing benediction. Friends, may people fear the name of God as they watch your life. Go in peace. Amen.